Thank you guys for coming. We're so glad that you're here with us this afternoon. My name is Courtney Villela. I teach high school English here at Canon Christian Academy, our school that we run through the church. And I also have taught in children's ministry for about 15 years now. I started in the nursery, and I was in there for 8 long years. And we grew out of that, and we grew into teaching in the classroom. And it comes naturally because we're teachers by trade, me and my husband, so it was a nice transition. Now I teach 11 and 12-year-olds. So I am so thankful that you guys are here today, and I'd like to start us with prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity you've given to us today to learn how to use the gifts that you've blessed us with. I pray, Lord, that you would be in our midst. I pray that you would give me the spirit of teaching, that you would help the message to be receptive, and that it would be well received by all those who see it and who hear your message, Lord. I pray that you would give us the capacity to take everything that we're talking about today and help us to put it into practice. And I pray, Father, that it would be a blessing to those who came today. It's in your holy, precious name we pray. Amen. Okay, so Pastor was just talking about the calling of a teacher, or the calling of using your gift and, you know, the next generation, how we need to make sure that we're raising them up the right way and teaching them the Word of God. And we know that our children will take on the legacy of Christianity to the next generation. And so it's a really important job to have to be a teacher. Now, the Bible has a few things to say about that. You know, the Bible tells us to train up a child in the way they should go, and when they're older, they won't depart from it. And it tells us also in James 3:1, let not many of you become teachers, because there will be a greater, I wrote it down, and I can't read my writing. A greater judgment, that's what it says, for those who do, because it's such an important calling to be a teacher. But if we have the gifting of teaching, we should be using that gift. And so I'm so thankful that you guys have been faithful to your home churches and that you're answering that call. And maybe you've been in children's ministry for a short time, or maybe it's been a long time. Maybe you're a teacher in an actual classroom in an actual school. It's a blessing to be able to use that gift and to be able to train up our children. But it can also be very daunting. Because when we answer that call, we're not always equipped to know what to do in the classroom. And so that's really what we're going to talk about today. I am going to be teaching on how to set up our classroom for success. Before we even have students in our classroom, what can we do to make sure that we have effective teaching and learning? So, I wrote, successful teaching and learning begin before class even starts. And I'm hoping that we'll be able to establish some norms for your classroom that will help you make a smoother transition into the classroom. So, preparedness. If you can make sure that you preview your lessons before your class starts, do it well in advance. We're talking about reading all the content, the instruction, the questions, the objectives, knowing what you want to teach, knowing what you should be praying for, what kind of big idea you want the kids to walk away from. If you can narrow that down to the one thing that you want them to know, and you can pray about it throughout the week, and you can make sure that all of your lesson planning is around that one topic, your classroom will be successful. Making copies is a huge part of making sure that your classroom is set up. I can tell you as a Sunday school teacher, but also as a high school teacher, the worst feeling is when I don't have what I need, and then I have to take time out of my class to get it, and it interrupts class time, so we're missing out on instruction time. But it also creates an opportunity for chaos, and we don't want the kids to sit idly by, because they will find something to do, and it's usually not great, right? Gathering supplies. If you're doing an object lesson, if you are doing a cut and paste, a craft, make sure that all of those things are ready to go, and that way you don't have to worry about trying to get those gathered while you're teaching as well. Here at our church, we have a really amazing resource room. If you teach at our church, or if you teach Sunday school at our church, that's available to all of the teachers to use as needed. And then, of course, we need to be prepared by planning our lesson. Now, I did go ahead and break down that lesson plan into 6 steps. My husband, Chris Villela, will be teaching the second session about how to make purposeful lesson plans. This is just mainly an overview of the kind of steps that you can take to make that process a little bit smoother for you. So first, like I said earlier, identify your learning goal. Our curriculum does a really great job of saying what the big idea should be. And when you narrow it down to that one learning goal, you can teach that to your students no matter what age level they are. So if they're little kids, and we teach our little kids that God is good, everything should be planned around God is good. And that works for older kids too. And I do this in my classroom when the kids first walk in. On my board, I have a chalkboard in my classroom, and I write 3 things down that I want them to do. I want them to write down the big idea, and whatever that is, whatever our goal is for the day, whatever our objective is for the day. I write down the memory verse so that they can tie scripture to that goal. And then I ask a question, something that's going to get them thinking about that big idea and that memory verse. The next one would be to determine the materials that you'll need to use to teach the lesson. This is where that preparedness comes in, how we talked about making copies and having all of your supplies ready to go. If you're going to do a craft, that you have it all worked out, you have the paper, you have the scissors. By thinking about this ahead of time, we can alleviate the stress of trying to get it ready the day before, and make sure that we're ready to go in our classrooms. This is where things like object lessons come in, because it's really sad sometimes whenever you teach a lesson and you think to yourself, oh, I could have done that object lesson, but I don't have the materials, right? So if we can think ahead of time about what kind of materials we would need to teach the lesson, we can build a more effective lesson. The third one is to write delving questions that will scaffold the lesson for students and lead them to the learning goal. You know, I told you how on my chalkboard, I always have a question that will get the kids started thinking about the lesson that we're doing for the day, right? So if we can help the kids come to the understanding of whatever that big idea is through delving questions, we don't stand up at the front and just talk the whole time. We can ask them a question, we can engage them as students in our classroom. And it's less of a lecture and more of a whole class activity. And if we think about those questions ahead of time, we don't have to think on the spot. We never have to worry about shutting down because we can't come up with another really good question. The next one would be to prepare an anticipatory set to introduce the lesson to students for the first few minutes of class. And this is crucial to a well-run classroom. From the moment that your children or your students walk into the classroom, you want them to have something to do. Because remember how we talked about idleness? The kids, they're going to go crazy. They're going to talk to their friends. They're going to want to hang out. And they're going to show undesirable behaviors. Maybe not necessarily bad ones, but ones that are going to make it difficult to teach. And so we want them to have something to do as soon as they walk in. And we want it to be something that's meaningful for our lesson. So that anticipatory set is something that we can have the students do upon immediate entry of the classroom that is directly related to our lesson and our big idea. So some examples of these could be a question. Like I told you, I like to put the question up on the board. It gets them thinking. They have to write. It gives them an opportunity to think about the topic that's on the board. You can do an activity. I know some people, especially for our curriculum and a lot of the younger kids, it'll have a little game. Let's play a little game that'll get us thinking about what our big idea is for the day. Maybe it's giving them a blindfold and them trying to find their way through the classroom and setting up the desks so that they have to try and navigate in the dark, right? And then they have a leader that's supposed to tell them what to do, and then finally they get to take it off. And that might teach how we need Jesus to illuminate things. We need those blinders taken off so that we can navigate through the world, right? So it can be an activity that's tied to our learning goal. It can be a reading assignment. So maybe it's look up your memory verse in your Bible, write it down, and copy down whatever passage is there. It can be a game, similar to an activity, right? So I know in the past we've done like Simon Says, and we can do that with memory verses or just even just to get them moving and get all the wiggles out. And then, of course, I know Jim and Peggy's favorite is the object lesson or demonstration. We can have that already set up and we can say, it's time to take a seat. Watch this. This is what we're going to do today and do the object lesson. It immediately engages the students and gets them ready for learning. And if we can make sure that our anticipatory set is prepared and that it is something that they do immediately upon entering the classroom, we should be able to alleviate some of those undesirable behaviors. The fifth thing in planning our lesson is to prepare an activity, an assignment, a worksheet that will assist the students in learning the lesson and demonstrate their understanding of the learning goal. For younger kids, I wrote, this could be as simple as a coloring page. I know in our curriculum we do use that. We have the lesson, we have some sort of activity, and then we also have a coloring page that the kids can sit down and it's directly related. If we're talking about God's promises, it'll most likely be a rainbow, right? Or Noah's Ark. And it's something that's directly related to the learning goal. For older kids, this could be questions and answers. In my grade, with the 11 and 12-year-olds, we have true and false, fill in the blank. We have crossword puzzles. We have word searches, all related to the memory verses that we do. So if we can make sure that we have some sort of assignment that directly reinforces the lesson that we've taught, they're probably more likely to remember it. And it gives them something that they can take home to their parents to see what exactly did you learn today and how well did you learn it. And they enjoy reviewing these. Some of the activities that I wrote down are the wordless book. You can do crafts, you can do writing assignments, you can give homework, but you can also do some of these ones. Sorry. The wordless book, I don't know, is anyone familiar with a wordless book? Yeah? Where the different colors mean different parts of the gospel. This is really great for little kids who can't read, right? They can look at it, you can go through the wordless book, you can tell them what all the pages mean, you can recreate it with construction paper, super easy. Another variation of that would be bracelets with the beads, and they have the same color. So if you have older kids and they're working on those skills, you could have them put beads on the bracelet and they can have that to take home. And it's still just as meaningful as doing something on paper. You can do rainbow crafts, bookmarks with scripture, and art. Any sort of art project that's created by the kids. What's really great about this is that anything that's hands-on is going to reinforce whatever lesson you taught in the classroom. So it's really important to have something that is tangible for them to take home that reinforces that activity or that lesson. And then finally, we need to prepare the closing for the lesson. You have to consider how you're going to wrap up your lesson and summarize and reinforce your learning goal. You can ask your students questions, give them homework, and always pray with them within the context of the lesson. So, something that I like to do is I like to send my students home with some sort of handout. We do have handouts that we use in the classroom. We'll go over that, and then they take that home. And then, likewise, having them copy stuff off of the board, answering the questions, having the memory verse, they take all of that home as well. So they're producing something, I'm producing something, and we're reinforcing it every time we go over that. Now, another key component to effective classroom management and preparing a classroom that's conducive to learning would be to create a safe and respectful learning environment. This is important in any classroom, whether it's in a school or in Sunday school, but it's especially important in Sunday school. We only see our kids once, maybe twice a week, and we only see them for a really short time. So we need to make sure that they enjoy themselves and that they want to come back, that they feel loved. And if we can make that happen through setting the environment up to be welcoming, they're more likely to be excited about it and want to come back. So this is kind of like a bulleted list of things that I think make a classroom really welcoming. First of all, the classroom arrangement. We want to make sure that if we have desks, that they're facing the speaker. If we have tables, they're facing the speaker. Rugs for little kids. I know we do rug time, right? We sit them in a circle. We want to make sure that whatever arrangement we have in our classroom, it's going to fit the needs of our students' developmental age and then also our lesson. So for little kids, we're probably not going to sit them in big kid desks and expect them to sit quietly the whole time. We're probably going to have a little sitting circle on a rug. And we want to make sure that we have all of those needs met ahead of time. In order to do this, we want to make sure that, or by doing this, we want to make sure that we're engaging our students and that they're not distracted and that they're not going to have any disruptions. And we can avoid that by making sure our classroom's set up, but also make sure that we have those kids that we know are probably going to become distracted or distract others sit far away from each other, right? The other thing is that we need to welcome our students. Kids want to know that you love them. Whether they're little kids or older kids, we want to make sure that we make them feel welcomed. And we can do that by smiling at them, greeting them, asking them how their day is, engaging them in conversation before we go into the classroom or even at the beginning of the class. We want them to know that we want them to come back, and that we value them, and that they're loved. We can use calming music. In my classroom, when the kids walk in, I told you that we have those three things written up on the board. I will play worship music while they're completing that. And that way it kind of sets the mood, it sets the tone, it sets the atmosphere of the classroom. If we want kids to be excited and cheerful and joyful and we're gonna play a little bit, it might be more upbeat music. If we want them to really calm down because we have a rowdy group, we might play more calming music. And then we'll get into how we can use music to help manage our time in the classroom a little bit later. We can use calming smells. My husband does this. He has a little Scentsy warmer in his classroom, and it always smells like cookies walking down the hallway. We're always very disappointed that it's only wax. But kids that, you can help with that aromatherapy. You can help it to calm the kids down that need to be calm or to just be pleasant to everybody else. The one thing I would say about this is that, I even marked it here, that you want to avoid scents that could be bothersome to some of the more sensitive kids, especially if they have real sensitivities to that. But other than that, we all enjoy a pleasant smell, so that could help set the atmosphere. And next is snacks. I have found that snacks are a great way to a child's heart, especially in Sunday school. Some of them come and live just for the snacks, and they're a little disappointed when we don't have them, but it could be a really great way of avoiding distractions in the classroom. You know, if kids walk in and they're grumpy because they haven't eaten breakfast yet, well, they're probably going to need something to eat to kind of calm them down, get them focused, and alleviate some of those issues. And this can be simple. For little kids, it could be little animal crackers, like what we do in our nurseries and our twos and threes. In my classroom, I bring a wide variety of things. I've given them suckers and cookies, cupcakes for birthdays, and it could be anything. It doesn't have to be anything expensive. And then water. They're pleased with that. What's really great about this is that you could use this as a way of behavior modeling, like we'll talk in the next session. But I want to talk about it now since we're on the subject. This is a great way of getting kids involved. You can have them hand out the snacks. You can have them hand out the water, especially if it's a kid that's a little bit more antsy or a kid that's a little bit more disruptive. Giving them a task to do can really help them kind of calm down a little bit. This can be built into your lesson. So I know for our little kids, they actually have a snack time. That's part of their lesson. And for the older kids, it could be something that you do at the very, very end of the lesson when you have a little bit of extra time. You can use it whenever they're answering questions as a reward for completing tasks. So it can be used as a tool as well. Toys, especially when working with younger kids. Giving kids something to play with when they first walk in can help settle them down. Because we know that fidgets are a real big thing right now, right? Even the older kids, they like spinners, they like those little fidget cubes. Giving kids a toy that is pre-selected by the teacher that's appropriate for the age can really help them get ready for the class. Because if they want to do something with their hands, that gives them an opportunity to play around without being distracting. And then finally, posters and decor. Now I know that's really difficult sometimes to have posters and decor in the classrooms because a lot of them are Is it back on? There it is. At our school in particular, we share our classrooms with teachers and Sunday school teachers. And so not everything can be permanent. We can't always post stuff up on the walls. But having one poster, a couple of visuals that can help aid our teaching or our lesson, like having the scripture or having a picture that's related to whatever we're doing. So in the event that we're doing God's promises, like I said earlier, we could do a rainbow. We can do the scripture and put it up on the board. And that's something that we can easily just put away and get rid of whenever we're done with it. It doesn't have to be permanent. But having things that kids can engage in and look at. You know, we have those students that they're going to learn by seeing, they're going to learn by writing, and they're going to learn by listening, right? And we want to reach all three of those learning styles. Okay. Yeah, it does. I don't know what that was. Thank you. No, you're fine. All right, next. After we've already kind of set up that learning environment, we can think about how our classroom will function. And this is where it gets a little bit more interesting, I think. Establishing expectations is so important in making sure that your classroom runs smoothly, because kids like to know what's expected from them. They like to know what's going to happen first, second, next, last. They want to know because it gives them an expectation for how their day's gonna go. It's a safe feeling whenever they know exactly what to expect. And it's also a good time behavior management strategy. So first you want to make sure that you have rules. Even little kids can follow directions. They can understand rules. And I'll give you a couple of examples of those in a minute. But you want to make sure that your rules are short, general, manageable. If they're too specific, you're going to have a few behavior problems, or you're going to have a bunch of rules. So you don't want that. You want to limit your rules between 3 and 5, and you want them to be general and broad in scope so that they'll cover a lot of different behaviors. And then you also want to make sure that they are enforceable. All right. So those rules and expectations, let's get back into that. We want to make sure that they're between 3 and 5 rules and that they're easy to remember. And we want to make them general enough that they're wide in scope to cover lots of different behaviors, lots of different expectations. We want to make sure that they're enforceable, so that the consequences of breaking them is not overwhelming. We never want to give them a rule that they can't follow or a consequence that we can't enforce, right? And then, of course, we want to make them developmentally appropriate. For little kids, it could be something as simple as looking eyes, helping hands, walking feet, listening ears, quiet voices. All of these can be tied to actual movements, right? We can have posters that show what we're looking for. And this could go along with like the visuals that we keep in our classrooms that we pack up with us at the end of the class and we put out whenever we're starting it. And then we can model that for them too. We could say looking eyes, helping hands, walking feet. So we can demonstrate what we want them to do. We can practice those rules with them. And even little kids will be able to understand that. Some examples for older students. This first one is one that I use in my classroom. I tell them every class, I only have 3 rules. Stay in your seat, raise your hand before you speak, and then wait for permission to do something or to talk. Very simple, because those are the 3 things I need them to do to make sure I can do what I need to do. And so I keep it really simple. It's not laborious. It's not super strenuous on them. They understand them, no big deal. Another one could be respect your teacher, peers, resources. Follow classroom procedures, do your best work. Another one could be come to class on time and prepare to work, stay on task, be respectful. So whatever is most important to you and to the teaching that you're going to be doing, the learning that you want your students to be doing, needs to be what you're targeting those roles around. And then building routines. Routines are your friend. If you have routines for everything, there's a right way to do it every single time. And kids will adapt to that because most of them are people pleasers, right? Especially when they're younger. They want to be told that they're doing a good job. So they're going to follow your rules and your expectations if you make them known to them. You want routines. They can be anything. You can have a routine for everything. How to enter the classroom, how to start the class, how to ask a question, how to participate in class discussions, to sharpen pencils, to throw away trash, to go to the bathroom, to turn work in. Whatever it is, make sure that if you're going to have a student perform a task or do something, you have a way that they're supposed to do it correctly that meets your expectation. And that way, you never have kids that are a little chaotic and not knowing what to do. And they don't have to be task specific, meaning you don't have to have an individual and unique routine for each class, and for each task, rather. You can chunk them together. So the example I gave was sharpening pencil, throwing away trash, asking a question, can all have the same routine. Raise your hand and you wait for me to call on you. Simple, right? Teacher, I need to sharpen my pencil. Teacher, I need to throw something away. Teacher, I dropped something on the floor. All they have to do is raise their hand and you can give them permission to do what they need to do. Sometimes this is you need to wait until we're done with our anticipatory set. So you, in the first 5 minutes, you know not to bother me because you should be working, and giving a routine for how they should complete their work as well. You control the behavior in your classroom when you retain the authority of your classroom. And that's really important. As long as you have the authority in your classroom, you're the one making the rules, setting the expectations, calling the shots, you're going to maintain good behavior in the classroom. When students don't know what to expect, they begin to do whatever they want and however they want. And there's really no way we can blame them because we haven't given them clear ways of doing things and acting in our classroom. And we need to make those clear because, like I said earlier, kids like to know what to do. They like the safe routine. And they're going to follow the easier path, right? They're not going to kick against the goads, as the Bible says, so much if they know where they're supposed to go, what they're supposed to do. And we want to make sure that our classrooms are so predictable that even if we're not there, they can still follow all the procedures. That's why, especially with only having Sunday school kids once a week, I have the same exact routines. Because I know if I switch that up on them and they've been gone for 1 week and they come back, it's going to be a little frustrating because they're not going to know what to do. So I keep my routines for Sunday school absolutely the same every single day. I do that with my high schoolers too. We always have bell work because they know as soon as they walk in the classroom, that's what they need to do. And they get started almost immediately for the obedient ones, of course. But we want to make sure that they know the routine, that they can complete the routine, and that it's something that's manageable. So I have some example routines for you on the last page. We can build these routines, and we'll talk more about the specifics in the next session, but these are some routines that we could use in our classrooms and do it immediately, teach it immediately, use it immediately, and the kids will catch on very quickly. So the routine of raising the hand. If you need to ask a question, what do we do? If we have to go to the bathroom, what do we do? If we have to sharpen the pencil, what do we do? So I always teach them, you're going to raise your hand, wait to be called on, and then when I call on you, you can speak. That's my routine for any question, any activity, anything that you need to speak for or get out of your seat for, raise your hand, right? And that's pretty standard in every classroom, I would bet. The routine for entering the classroom. For my secondary students, I have them sign in a book. So they know as soon as they come into the classroom, they're going to sign in because they like to be tardy. And they're going to sign in to show that they were on time, right? And that when the bell rings, they should be in their seat. And they should be starting on their bell work. For kids' church, what that looks like is I'll tell them, you come into the classroom silently. You take out a Bible. You copy the verses off the board. And so they know exactly what that expectation is. And the moment that they don't do that expectation, I reinforce it. And I say, remember how we're supposed to enter the classroom? Quietly, we sit down, we get our Bibles, and we start working. The next one would be passing out and collecting resources. This, again, is a great, not only a classroom management tool, but a behavior management tool. I select two kids always, because I need to pass out papers and I need to pass out pencils. I select two kids, and that's sort of like a reward for them. They want to be helpers. Or I'll select the kid that's having a tough day, and I'll make that kid a helper so that I can alleviate the behavior, but I can also get done what I need to get done. And I have those kids pass all the materials out and go collect all the materials back. So I have just two kids walking around the classroom instead of having all the kids walking around the classroom. We need to make sure that we have transitions from one task to another task. If we're starting off with the anticipatory set and then we're moving into our lesson, there should be some sort of transition that they can do that will keep that transition very short. Because remember, downtime is no good for a classroom. We want to make sure that every moment of that class time is filled, whether it's independent work, a whole class activity, small groups, whatever it is, we want to make sure that every moment is filled. So transition times can be a little chaotic. Okay, now we're going to transition from writing down our stuff to doing a craft. What does that look like? I'm going to give you however many seconds to throw away all your trash and to get your scissors out, whatever it is, right? We want to be able to tell them what they need to do, how they're going to do it, when they're going to do it. And then we can use commands. I like the when, then, or if, then commands. When, then is a little better because it's a command, not necessarily a choice. So if I say, when you stop talking, we will begin our lessons, then you can begin your lesson. Or when you are in your seats, then I will dismiss you. It gives them clear instructions of exactly what I want them to do and what they have to do in order to get that done. If then is a little different. If then can be used in settings where you maybe want to give a reward. If everyone completes their homework this week and brings it back next week, then I will give you all a reward, right? So it gives them a choice, an option there. Other routines that we want to build in are bathroom passes. Something very simple as, what do I do when I need to go to the bathroom? In our church, we have coordinators and we have helpers that stand in the hall and some are in the classroom, and we have them escort our students to the bathroom. That might look different in nursery and in twos and threes, because I believe, if you're changing diapers and you're kind of held up with one task, you have to have someone else to help you with the other tasks. So that may be different from church to church, but it's important to establish what that routine is, because there's nothing like being in the nursery all by yourself with no helpers because they took a bathroom break, right? So we want to make sure that we establish what that looks like. And finally, thinking about our classroom and how it will operate will teach, thinking about how your classroom will operate and how you will teach your lesson ahead of time will make class time much more efficient and effective with less disruptions. If you know what you're teaching, how you're teaching it, and how you want the students to behave, and that's already planned out, you can go into the classroom with confidence. And I know that there's so many people that they have a desire to serve in their church. They have a desire to serve in kids' church, and they just don't know how to make that effective. They don't know what it should look like. And so having all of that planned out ahead of time means that you don't have to walk into a classroom and kind of think, what should we do next? Right? Or run out of time, or have too much time at the end. If we have that all planned out, we never will find ourselves frustrated or struggling. At least we shouldn't, right? Thorough preparation will help to avoid classroom disruptions and downtime and ensure a positive teaching and learning experience for all. Above all, a classroom that is inviting, enriching, and well planned out will ensure we reach our goal to teach God's word to all of his children and help them grow in their relationship with the Lord. We have to remember that at the end of the day, when a kid walks into our classroom, especially a Sunday school classroom, we're there to show them the love of Jesus. And we want that to be conveyed effectively. If we can make sure that we're diligent with our time, if we can make sure that we're diligent with our planning, there's no reason why kids shouldn't know who Jesus is. If we're flustered and we're frustrated and we're getting angry or we've lost control of the classroom, those lessons can't be taught. So we need to make sure that we're thinking about, what do I want my classroom to look like? What is age appropriate? And how am I going to build those routines? Now, I have finished early, so we could always open it up to discussion for a couple of minutes. Does anyone have any questions about preparing the classroom? Things that maybe you've done in your classroom? Yes. So last year, I tried to condense all of that into one session, and it was too much. So what I've done this year is I'm going to break it up into two, and I'll be teaching that part tomorrow. So that's called behavior management. And when we're trying to manage behaviors, we are first trying to avoid the behavior in the first place by building the routines and setting the rules and setting the standards so that they can know what to do right so that they don't do the wrong thing. But there's also behavior modification that says after we've already established all the rules, what do we do when they break it or when they don't follow the expectation? And I'll get a little bit into that right now, actually. When that happens, one really important thing that we need to note is that when we set up rules and expectations, our first expectation should be that they will break them and they will not meet the expectation, which is great. Because what that creates is a learning opportunity for you to correct the behavior. And we'll go more into how we go about correcting behavior, how we avoid those unwanted behaviors in the next session. Does that help a little bit? Okay. You'll be back. I can tell you that one's probably a lot more interesting, a lot more helpful, because we get into a classroom, we can have the perfect lesson, we have the perfectly planned out classroom, and then we get our mix of kids, and like, oh my gosh. What do we do with that? Because, kids are humans and they have emotions and they're rowdy and they have their own personalities. And how do we make that conducive to a learning environment is really important. Any other questions or maybe suggestions, Ms. Sanchi? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, gosh. So here's my take on it. There are some kids who are diagnosed with behavior issues. And there are some kids that just are a little bit more distracted than others. And toys really do help them stay focused. But remember how we were talking about having expectations and building routines and having rules. I always preface that with, if you use this appropriately, then you get to keep it. But if you don't, then I'm going to take it away. And then they lose it. So they see it as a privilege. You offer that privilege and they feel a little special because you're allowing them to do something that's usually not allowed. And then you're giving them making sure that they're meeting all the expectations otherwise. A really good example of this is in my classroom for the 11 and 12-year-olds. They're a funny little bunch, talking about that close to middle school age. I taught middle school for a very long time. And what I noticed with them is that you have to be the authority, but you also have to give them a little bit of freedom. So when they walk into my classroom, I immediately say, you can sit wherever you want, next to whomever you want. But if you don't follow the rules, I get to choose where you sit next time. And I had a situation this last Sunday where we had a couple of little real chatty girls and they sat right next to each other. They were friends. And I said, you guys can sit there so long as you can follow my rules. But the moment you don't follow my rules, I'm gonna move you. And they said, yes, ma'am, I'm sorry. And they were fine the rest of the class. And so I think we could set that as a standard as well. Having something, as long as it's not distracting to them or to other kids, it might be worth giving it a try. And then you can always build expectations around that. You're only allowed to keep your toy. You're not going to be sharing toys, whatever it is. And I think that's where that pre-selected toy is a good thing to consider. Because for little kids, we don't want the ones with like all the crunchy sensory stuff in it, because that's going to be really distracting. But a nice little soft stuffed animal, totally fine. A hard toy that they can gnaw on if they're a little smaller. Things that are appropriate. So we don't want to say, oh yeah, you can have a toy in my classroom. It could be anything. And then it's one of those clickers. No, not that one. So pre-approved choice, the Poppets, you're right. Those are really big right now. The Poppets can get a little distracting.
So I keep having this recurring issue in
fifth grade. Oh no, is it my son? Okay. He's my son's teacher.
Your son's great. Oh.
I think it's just referring back to the routines and the expectations. The expectation is that it should be look like this. And maybe you have to amend that, because maybe you don't want it three stories tall, but you weren't thinking that they would make it three stories tall. So maybe you say, you know what, new rule. It has to be this size. And then when it's not that size, you refer back to what was the rule. I had this happen with a student recently that they turned in an activity that we did. And she did a great job on it. It looked beautiful, but it didn't meet the requirements, the criteria for the rubric. And she got a B instead of an A. And I told her what her grade was, and she goes, I said, I'm sorry. Do you not like the grade that I gave you? And she said, well, I just thought I did better work than that, and I thought I should have gotten a better grade. And I'm like, okay. And it's important not to take it personally, first of all, right? And I told her, well, did you meet all the requirements of the rubric? And she started going through the requirements. She goes, well, no. And I said, so do you think you deserve the A? And she's like, well, I guess not. She wasn't happy about it still. But then it didn't matter, because it wasn't me telling her she did bad. It's that she self-assessed and saw that she didn't meet the requirements. And then she was given an opportunity to fix it. If you would like the A, you can go back and fix it. She didn't take the opportunity. At that point, it didn't matter, I don't think. But we can do that in the classroom, too. Did you meet the requirements of the desk pet stuff? Okay, well, maybe now you lose it for a week. Until you can meet the requirements, you don't get one. Right? Same with the toy. Until you meet the requirements, you don't get a toy. And that reinforces that they have the power to choose to do the right thing or choose to do the wrong thing. And maybe you take it away for a minute. And that's the beauty of like individual consequences versus whole group consequences too. Because if you took everyone's away, it kind of kills the activity, right? It kind of kills that intrinsic motivation to do right. But if you take it away just from the one kid, take the toy away just from the one kid and everyone else gets toys, that's a little bit of a bummer, right? Then maybe they'll try better next time. And then you let them know what they can do to earn it back. Next time we come to class, if you can make sure that you're not distracted, we'll try again. Once you show me that you have a desk pet that meets the requirements, you can include it on your desk again. Does that help? Yeah. But you know what's so easy about it is just telling them, okay, then you can't participate. And not being able to participate in something is like the end of the world for a little kid. They hate it. Oh, yeah. And then you tell them, until you have the right heart and attitude, you don't get to participate. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Yes. Right, right. Yeah. And you know, I think you made a really important point, which I meant to make. You know, when we're managing behavior, it's not so we can have little soldiers sitting in our classroom that you know, are like little robots. They just do what we say. It's so that we can have teachable moments. We can get that lesson across. But even in the bad behavior, those are still teachable moments. We get to reinforce, like you said, God's word. We can reinforce the good things. Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah. And you know, I think when we do that, like I said, when we talk about behavior modification a little later or tomorrow, when we do that, we will have less and less behaviors. Because if our only go-to is we scream and yell and kick them out, if that's what we do, there's no learning taking place. And we know that God's word is good for correction and instruction and reproof, right? It tells us that we can use it for every aspect of learning. So, like I was saying, if we just kick them out, they haven't learned a lesson, and they're going to exhibit that behavior over and over and over again. So if we can teach them that lesson, and they can learn from it, and they know what to do right the next time, hopefully we'll have less disruptions and distractions and bad behaviors in the classroom. You had your hand raised, right? So for our church in particular, I can't speak for every church, but for our church, absolutely. Of course, we're safe. We use Clorox wipes before we get in. If like we're going to do an activity like that, we're going to sanitize everything. If it needs to be sanitized after, we're going to do that as well. For the consumables like Play-Doh, you know, Play-Doh's cheap. I feel like it would be just as easy to have them make something and take it home. And then you don't have to worry about it. Oh, does it? I didn't know that. Or maybe you can have them make their own Play-Doh in class, and then they can take it home. So as far as manipulatives go, though, we do use manipulatives here, yeah. Yes, ma'am. I use it at my discretion, because some things I don't want, like if it's a test, no, of course not. If it's an assignment that I gave them a lot of time to work on and they just didn't take the effort to do it, no. But if it's something that it was an honest mistake, they understand their mistake and they're willing to put in the effort, I'll consider it, yeah. But no, you don't have, it doesn't have to be policy that you get to correct it, yeah. And, you know, I think that goes along with the consequences that are manageable. If you're not willing to follow through with that every single time, and there are going to be parameters for when you follow it and when you don't, then you don't want to say, and you get to correct your work whenever you want, right? Because I did do that 1 year, and what happened was kids would kind of blow it off with the idea that, oh, I can just redo it. I can just redo it, right? And sometimes behaviors in our classroom are like that too, right? Like, I'm going to give you a warning, and I'm going to give you this, I'm going to give you that, right? We're going to talk about the whole sticker charts and clothespin things for behavior management, and sometimes you just need to send them straight out to someone who can be their authority immediately, right? So there's differing degrees of criteria, I guess. Yes, sir? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we really have to do whatever is going to help us get our goal across, right? To teach them about Jesus, to teach them about that big idea, that objective, whatever that is. And if we can do that and it helps the lesson continue, because we want to keep that rolling. We want to make sure that there aren't any disruptions, because remember, disruptions create chaos, and then we can't do what we need to do. But a lot of that depends on us. We have to have the discernment to know what strategy to use, when to use it, when to ignore bad behavior, and when to address it, and then how. And so if we can do that, we can make sure that that lesson happens the way it's supposed to happen, with minimal distraction. And if you need help, you need to call somebody in, do it. My husband has gone into a couple of different classes to chew out a couple of little kids that, you know, aren't behaving correctly, and to teach them how to behave correctly so that, you know, he can reinforce that for them. And sometimes they need that. Sometimes they need a walk to go and have some discipleship and get their wiggles out or their frustrations out, whatever it is. And knowing your students is so important to be able to know that. You know, if we're not building those relationships, if we're not greeting them, if we don't make a connection with them, they're less likely to listen to us if they don't want to. And they're less likely to want to upset us if they do know us and if we have built those relationships. So I think we are back on schedule now, right? 3:25? 2:25 to 3:25 is workshop one, so yes, okay. So thank you guys so much for bearing with me. I really hope you guys come to the second session. I think that will give you some really practical ways of implementing behavior modification. I'm going to give you very detailed things that you can do with your students for when they are building those routines and breaking the routines. So if that's something you're interested in, that'll be tomorrow. Does anyone want to pray for us? There's my husband in the back. He just walked away. Mr. Gremling, will you pray for us? Thank you. Amen.